just fight a little longer, my friend. It's all worth it in the end. But when you got nobody to turn to, just hold on and I'll find you. I'll find you. I'll find you. Just hold on and I'll find you.
I'm hanging on by a thread, and all I'm clinging to is prayers. And every breath is like a battle. I feel like I ain't come prepared. And death's knocking on the front door. Pain's creeping through the back. Fear's crawling through the windows, waiting for them to attack. They say don't get bitter, get better. I'm working on switching them letters. But tell God I'ma need a whole lot of hope keeping it together. I'm smiling in everyone's face. I'm crying whenever they leave the room. They don't know the battle I face. They don't understand what I'm going through.
Just fight a little longer, my friend. It's all worth it in the end. But when you got nobody to turn to, just hold on and I'll find you.
Awesome, everybody. That's some of the people I get to work out with. How fun is that? I might look like that in just a few weeks. Who knows? But I'm going for it. Time to be strong and courageous. We are starting a brand new series this week. Welcome all of you again who are joining us online. So glad you're here. We've got message notes, everybody, for the first time in forever. Pull those out. I want you to follow along, write some notes down, and let's jump into this series, which is really a continuation of a study of the book of Joshua that I began in the beginning of the new year. We're going to pick right up where that series left off today. And our theme verse comes out of the first chapter of the book of Joshua, where it says these powerful words. And I want you to read these with me, okay? So come along, join me for the ride. Have I not commanded you? Wait, there's like five of you doing this with me. I heard the internet louder than y'all. So come on, let's do this together. Have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous? Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Amen. I want to talk to you today about moving forward without fear. Say that, moving forward without fear. Because I don't think I'd have to do much of a survey at all. I don't think I'd have to go talk to a whole bunch of you and find out that pretty much everybody in here, everybody connected, is dealing with some area in your life where fear is talking to you. Fear is talking to you probably louder than you're hearing God. I remember when I was just getting married. I was 20 years old. Actually, I was only 2 weeks into 20 when I got married, y'all. And it wasn't like I had 100 women that were chasing me down. There was just, why are you laughing? Does that not seem possible? There was just one. And even then, even though there was just one, I was 2 weeks into 20. Fear was talking to me just a little bit. Can I be real? Was I making the right decision? Was I making the right, what was it going to be like? What would our marriage be like? I didn't know. And so there was a little bit of fear. You know, that fear is keeping some people right now from ever getting married because they're just afraid. Fear is talking to them. They're afraid to make that commitment. People never get to where they want to be in life because they're afraid. I know what it's like to have fear talk to me. I remember when we started this church years ago, I was 29 years old, and I left security. I left working for my father-in-law in a great church, big church. They were just moving into a big building like this. I had family, friends, had everything, and yet God was burdening our hearts to come here to Indiana, like we were missionaries going to a foreign field. I don't know. We were coming to a place we didn't know anybody, and God was putting it in our hearts to start Heartland Church. And I have to tell you, even though I had a lot of faith that would all work out, I had fear talking to me. Fear was talking to me rather loud. In fact, fear talked to me really loud the day that we held our first service and zero people showed up. I can tell you that fear was talking really loud that day. And then people started coming. And do you think that when more people came, and soon we had hundreds of people in Heartland Church, do you think that fear stopped talking to me then? No. Because how many of y'all know, like, pastoring people is a little rough. It is not easy. White people are hard to pastor. No, hang with me here. Because, you know, you can say Hosanna one day, but then by Thursday, they're all saying crucify you. I mean, that's just the way it rolls. And that was then. Now you add the church of today with all of y'all, all your differences, all your cultural backgrounds, all your different political views. Oh, my Lord, was I crazy or what? I can tell you, fear will talk to you. But how many are glad I didn't give up? How many are glad we're still here? How many are glad we decided not to listen to the voice of fear? But fear will talk to you. That's why I'm excited about this book of Joshua, because it's all about what do you do when fear talks to you. Joshua is following Moses. Moses, like Moses, part the Red Sea, Moses. Imagine that's who you're following, that has a legacy of talking to God face to face, and then you can say to Pharaoh to his face, let my people go, that Moses. And you have to follow that guy. That's why the book of Joshua starts with these verses that are, he says over and over, be strong and courageous. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid. I will be with you. Even as I was with Moses, I will be with you. So be strong and courageous. Why is he telling that? Because the voice of fear was talking to Joshua. And it shouldn't be a surprise. The voice of fear was talking to the people 40 years before when they came to that same spot. They had come to that same spot under Moses' leadership, and they were supposed to go in. God had just parted the Red Sea and said, I'm setting you free from Egypt. All of these plagues had happened, and God says, I'm with y'all. Nothing can stop you. Now go in, possess the land. And the people got to that Jordan River, and they said, well, let's send some spies in just to be sure. So they sent 12 guys, Joshua and this one other guy named Caleb were 2 out of the 10. When they came back, they said to the whole people, we can't do this. We're afraid. There are giants in the land. Their defenses are too much for us. We'll be destroyed. 10 of them said, we're scared. 2 of them said, we got this. We got the Lord on our side. We can take them. Let's go forward. But let me tell you something. That day, fear was talking louder than the people were hearing God. And I want to talk about that today, because there are a lot of you today that you're hearing fear talk to you, and that voice is louder than you hearing God. Where are my people at today? Who am I talking to? Just me by myself? Does anybody know that fear is talking to you louder? I don't. You're all looking like you're holy, and you're all like, I don't know what you're talking about. I never have fear. So Joshua comes to this moment, and he's now, the Lord has said to him, 40 years later, this is your second shot. Don't miss it. Don't blow it. The fear is there, but he's saying, Joshua, be strong and courageous. And so he says to the people, remember this, we've talked about this. He commanded them, get your stuff ready. That which we've not been able to do in 40 years, we're going to do in 3 days. And he lines them up on the banks of the Jordan River, and they walk forward. He says, I don't care that it's in flood stage. Priests, step your feet, leaders of the people, pastors, step your feet in the water, and the water's going to part. And God recreates the miracle of the Red Sea, because he said, have I not promised you I will be with you as I was with Moses? So God shows up with his miracle-working power, and they cross through on dry land opposite Jericho. And I love that it has that little detail in there, because guess what? God may have done some miracles to get you where you are, and you're still going to end up in life opposite Jericho. You'll come across that moment where God may have done a lot of things for you, and all of a sudden you're faced with something that's bigger than you, that's stronger than you, that you think there's no way I'm going to be able to overcome that. And you know that those people crossed over opposite Jericho, and they said to themselves, what in the world are we doing? And they must have doubted themselves. But I want you to know something. This is the will of God for you. At some point in your life, God is going to lead you to face your fears. Write that down somewhere, because that's exactly what's going to happen. God's not going to allow you to go through life parked by fear. If you're going to follow him, he's going to try to develop some faith in you, where he's going to say, I know you're scared, but be strong and courageous. I'm going to be with you wherever you go. He's going to lead you to face your fears. That's really important, because Joshua had the life experience to realize some people make horrible decisions when they listen to the voice of fear more than they listen to God. And that's true for some of you here in this room today. You've made a bunch of horrible decisions in your life because you're just scared. You're scared. Fear starts talking to you. And I want to tell you something. If ever fear starts to rise up in the picture and it becomes the big motivating force of your life, listen, I've learned in my life that when fear starts to talk to me loudly, I actually run in the other direction of what fear is telling me to do, because I know that fear is not from God. In fact, write this down. This is not in your notes, but write this down, that never make life-altering decisions that are fueled by fear, because that's not of God. There's a lot of people that will come to you and try to make you be filled with anxiety. They'll give you messages of worry and fear. Anytime somebody comes and says that they're trying to fuel your decision-making process by fear, I don't care if they've got pastor in front of their name or reverend in front of their name, it ain't a God. And there's a lot of people today who are parked living by fear. Their whole message is fear. And my job as a pastor is to bring you the principles of God's word, to educate you as believers in Jesus, that when you smell that motivation, when you detect that source of fear behind the argument, you just need to step back and go, well, that's not of God. Who am I preaching to today? Well, how do you know, Pastor? Well, because God has said. God has not given us a spirit of fear. Read this with me. But of power and of love in us. So when you sense, when you detect that the argument is rooted in fear, like you better do something because look what's, you just know, you check it right there and go, that's not a God. And see, here's the thing. The problem is you've made bad decisions in life because fear has been driving you to do it, and you should just know that's not what God wants for me. In fact, one of the problems of fear is that it actually pushes you away from God. In fact, the reason why you lost your courage, the reason why you don't have faith is because you stopped listening to God. You just plowed ahead listening to the fear. And the problem with that is it makes you, see, if you'd have just got God back in view again, if you thought about who he is, what he's done, the character of God, the faithfulness of God, I wish I had somebody that would just say, I know what it's like to know the faithfulness of God. If you could recall that and you could remind yourself who God is and what he's done for you, you might listen to what he said and not listen to fear. So I want to help you. I feel that right now this is a word for somebody, not only today, but I think it's a word for all of us as part of this community to help you learn how in these days we're living to be strong and courageous. Because the voice of fear is talking loudly. And you've got to learn how to detect it, and you've got to learn how to fight it and how to be better at it. In fact, that's what I'm going to talk to you about for the next 6 weeks. I'm going to teach you how to fight fear. I'm going to teach you how the joy of the Lord is actually your strength. I'm going to actually teach you how to deal with the haters in the next few weeks. I'm going to help you. Listen, I'm going to devote a whole message how to be a strong and courageous single person in the world today. you're not ready for that one yet. I'm going to teach you how to have a strong and courageous marriage in this world that we're living in today. You don't want to miss any of the next 6 weeks because we're going to go through how can I actually be strong and courageous in a world where fear is talking loudly. So today, with the time I got left, I just want to build a foundation. I just want to help us deal with this idea. How can you live without fear? Is it even possible? So let me give you some background. Let me just teach you a little Bible. Can I do that for a moment? Can I just give you big picture? Because what happens is Joshua leads the people across. In fact, in the strength and the courage of the Lord, they take out Jericho and they take out 31 other kings. In fact, it takes them 6 years. God doesn't give it to them all at once, but over time, he gives them the victory after victory after victory, and they take possession of the land. Right as he's about to die, he calls them together and he says, listen, let me remind you again, be strong and courageous. You need to serve the Lord. You need to get rid of your idols. And what you need to do is follow him. Choose for this day who you'll serve. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord, but you all need to choose because you need to choose God, everybody. So what happens is he's not dead hardly any time at all, and the people begin to turn away from God. In fact, what happened was they needed to be strong and courageous to take the land. But what happened after they got in the promised land, they became blessed and prosperous, and they forgot the God who gave them all that blessing and prosperity. What ended up happening was that God began to see them drift, and he sent other nations to begin to plunder and rob them. And they're all going, what's going on? God, where are you? Have you forgotten us? And God's going, I didn't forget you. You forgot me. You turned away from me. You turned away from my commands. You stopped listening to me. And the book of Judges, which follows Joshua, has a theme verse. You know what it is? And the people did what seemed right in their own eyes. That's what happens when you get blessed and you get prosperous and you start thinking, well, I can do whatever I want to do. And the history of Israel is that story of maybe you get a leader once in a while that would turn people's hearts back to God, but for the most part, they're just doing what seems right in their own eyes. And things are going bad. And things are getting... So you have these books of history that just tell the story of people turning away from God. God trying to send people, turn back to God, and people not listening. By the time you get to the book of Isaiah, this is where God sends the big guns, the big major prophets. And he starts saying, judgment is coming. You all need to turn back to God. God's done putting up with you. And at that time, the nation of Israel is now divided. The people aren't even united anymore. They're fighting each other. Am I making a connection today? Do you understand? Does this sound familiar at all? And so God sends a prophet, and he starts to say, wake up, turn, change your ways, like come back to me. And for 40 chapters, it's just judgment is coming. Just like there were 40 years in the wilderness, so he just said, I'm going to have to bring something on you so that I will get some things out of you so that you're ready for what I want to bring you in. For 40 chapters, Isaiah begins to talk about what is going to come down on the people. And anytime a message of judgment is being proclaimed, people don't want to hear it. I know what that's like. When I was a kid, the worst thing I could ever hear, and I was a good kid, I didn't get in trouble too much, but the worst thing I would ever hear is when my mom would say to me, you wait till your father gets home. I'm going to tell your father. See, I don't wish that she would have just taken the wooden spoon and just dealt with me right there, like right in the moment. I'd rather she do that. Actually, I actually prefer the wooden spoon than the plastic spoon. We all learned that by experience. You don't want to have a plastic spoon on a wet behind coming out of the shower, but it happened, and I learned. I'm just telling you my story. I learned that you want the wooden spoon. I would have preferred she just dealt with it herself. But what she told me was when I got really bad, she would say, you wait till your father gets home. I'm going to tell him what you did. And that was the worst because now it wasn't the punishment. It was the dreading of judgment. You knew it was not going to be good. I had to think about it all day. Well, that's what's happening to the people of Israel. For 40 chapters, he's saying to them, judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. But about the 42nd chapter, there's a shift, and God begins to speak differently through Isaiah. Because he says this, I know that this problem was coming, that it was difficult for you. I know that you've gone through some pain, and I know that judgment has come, but I'm not going to leave you there in it. I'm going to bring you through it. You have to go through it. I've got to get some stuff out of you. But when I bring you through it, I'm going to bring you out on the other side, and you're going to be better off for it. God's not going to leave you there. That's an encouraging word. That's good news. I love that about God, that the purpose of judgment is not just to push you down. The purpose of judgment is not just to crush you. He's trying to talk to you. And I don't know who I'm talking about today, but have you been wondering if you're asking, God, where are you? Why are you letting the drama happen in my life? You know why? Because he's trying to get your attention. God is trying to talk to you. God's trying to communicate to you. He's trying to say, I'm trying to get you to change the direction of your life. The way you're going is leading to destruction. Turn around, come the other way. But people won't listen. In fact, this is the issue Isaiah is addressing right on the peak of this shift from judgment to here's what God's going to do for you. In Isaiah chapter 42, he says, you know, people are going, God, why? Like, how is this happening? And God's going, I was behind it. I was trying to talk to you. I was trying to get you to turn around. I was trying to communicate to you. That's why I sent. That's why people robbed you and plundered you. That's why you went through situations where you felt like you were on fire. That's why you were going through all of that. And watch what he says, but you wouldn't even listen. See, here's the thing. They wouldn't take it to heart. Think about that. God's been saying, would you just turn around? And people wouldn't listen. And some of you today, I'm just bringing you this word that the reason for the drama, the reason for all of the pain and all the stuff that's going on, it's not that God's abandoned you, not that God doesn't know what's going on. God's using all of that to get you to try to turn you around, to get you back on track. And let me tell you something, that's good news. You don't realize it. The purpose of judgment is to bring us back to him. God's trying to bring you out of where you are. He's trying to turn you around, but you won't listen. And so this is good news. This is good news because God doesn't want to leave us where we are. He wants to turn things around. Let me just take a breath right there. Do you realize God wants to turn you around? that he wants to make. See, that's the good news for me. I know that if he brings me out of something, that he's going to turn it around for good, and I'm going to be better off than I was before. He doesn't leave me where I am. That's what God was trying to do with Israel. I know it's painful. I know it's hard. But if you follow me, if you turn, it's going to be better. That's why Isaiah 43 is like the turning point. Because God says to the nation, he says, judgment's coming. It's going to be hard. But after you go through it, it's going to be better. And he gives them a vision of hope. And I love this verse. And I'm going to put, it's in your notes. And I want you to see what God says at this turning point of history where he says, I know it's been hard. I know judgment's come. But let me tell you what's about to happen. Watch this in verse 1 of chapter 43. I love the two words that it starts with. It says, but now. It's like all of that in the past was yesterday. But now. And anytime you come to a place where you don't like what you're going through and you turn to God, God's saying there is a moment of transition that's about to happen. That's what that's talking about. This is a moment of transition in your life that God wants to turn around. When he puts his but now into your situation, you know you're about to transition. Come on, somebody. He wants to turn you around. So he says, but now, says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, fear not. You don't have to be afraid. And he calls them, he says, you don't have to be afraid of the judgment. Turn to me, and I'm going to help you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to prosper you. I'm going to do some things for you. In fact, he gives them five reasons why they don't have to be afraid. And he lists them one right after the other in this passage. I'm going to give them to you today. They're so clear. Five clear statements from God why you don't have to be afraid. And I think it's for somebody today. Write this down. The first thing that God says in this little passage, in this verse, number one, he says, God has created you. Oh, I get excited about that. He's created you. Actually, in the Hebrew, it means a little more than in English. This word actually means, if we were to say it in our way, it would be, he chose you to be created. He selected you to be created, which is amazing because God found all of us somewhere. God saw you in the mess that you were in. He saw you where you were in life. He saw where you had gone and how far you had fallen, and he reached down and he picked you up and he said, I choose you for something special. I've chosen you for something great. I'm going to take you where you are and I'm going to make something out of you. I'm going to take you and change you. Behold, I'm going to take you and make you into something new, and they won't even recognize who you are. I'm thankful that God did that. I'm thankful that God reached down and picked some of you where you used to be. When you used to be living in sin and you were far from God, and God just reached down, he saw you, he plucked you out, and he turned you around. He got you out of that whole life, whatever you were in, and he pulled you out, and here you stand today. Can I get a witness? Anybody? Whatever drugs, whatever you were shacking around with, whatever you were going on in your life, whatever was happening, and you were far from God, weren't even thinking of him, and God just went, I got something for you. And he pulled you out. I'm going to recreate you into something that's better. I'm glad God does that for church kids. I was a church kid. I was raised. I was in church before I was born, everybody. I was in church every day of my life. And how many of you know you can be in a church sitting on the row and your heart be far from God, sliding off the end on your way to hell? That's exactly who I was. But one day, God just went like this. He says, I want you to know me. He started to recreate me. God reached down and he plucked me out of that church chair and he began to turn my life around. I didn't do anything to earn it. I didn't do anything to deserve it. He just said, now is the time, and he woke me up out of my religion that I was in and he turned my life around. He says, I'm going to take somebody who's just ordinary, someone who's common, and I'm going to raise you up and make you part of a royal priesthood, a chosen generation. I'm going to do something in your life for your generation that you can't even imagine. That's what God did for me. I get excited when I think about what God wants to create out of your life. You're not all that you're supposed to be. You're not everything that God wants for you yet. God wants to create something out of your life. I wish I could preach this better. God has created you. But watch else what he says. He says, God has formed you. And I love this part. He's formed you. which means, that word means he's just squeezing you into his mold. He's squeezing you, he's shaping you, he's molding you. He's letting, you should thank God for all the things that you've gone through in your life that squeezed you. He was just trying to squeeze some of the hell out of you and turn you around. You shouldn't be crying about it. You shouldn't be complaining about what you went through, because God saw there were some things that were in you that I had to squeeze to get out of you so that you could be what I'm trying to get you to be. God looks at you. I mean, this is the whole idea of the potter and the clay, and how God takes you and he puts you on his wheel and he begins to spin you and he begins to shape you and he begins to apply pressure. And then the clay sometimes resists what the potter is trying to do. I don't know if you've ever seen that, but sometimes the potter will sense all the resistance and it's not working the way he wants it to go. So he'll stop the wheel and he'll pick up that clay and he'll just smash it down and he'll start all over again. How many of you have had a smashing experience happen in your life where God just says, wake up? You know, it's like a wake-up call. And he says, it's not going the way I want. So God just, but he starts over. And he starts to shape you and he applies pressure. And you know what? This helps me. This gives me encouragement to know that everything that I've been through in my life, it was all serving the plan of God. Because truthfully, there are some things in my life that I don't like. How about you? Anybody else? You got things in your life right now you don't like? You got things in your life that you wouldn't have chosen if it was just you. I got things like that. But you ought to learn how to thank God for everything that he brought you through. Because I realized, looking back over my life, I can't be who I am today if I hadn't gone through what I've been through in my life. God was using all of it. God was taking all of that heartache. Listen, God took all your headaches, all of your heartaches. God took all of the hills you had to climb, and he was in all of it because he knew it had to develop the humility in you for the greatness that he had ahead of you. That's what God was trying to do. And you couldn't get there if he didn't shape you and form you. Who am I talking to today? You got to thank God today. You got to praise God today for all of the stuff that squeezed you and shaped you, whether you liked it or not. Because listen, how many of you know that the devil can't mess with you unless he goes through God? Actually, the Bible teaches that. Bible teaches that he has to ask God's permission in order to mess with you. So here's what I know, that if God okayed it, then I'm going to come through it. And if I come through it, I'm going to come out better than I was before, because he's still forming me. He's formed me. So it excites me that he's working through everything. So he's created me and he's formed me, but watch what else. He's redeemed me. And I love this word, because redeemed means, listen, God sees value in you that you don't even see in yourself. And that's good, because a lot of you wouldn't even give a nickel for yourself at certain times of your life. And yet God says, I see value in you. And so he redeemed means that he bought you with a price. He paid a high price. The devil stole from you, ripped you off, put you into slavery, threw you down in the ditch, and God comes along and pulls you up out of that ditch, pays for you by the blood of his own son, Jesus, and redeems your life and says, you are mine. I'm going to use you for something great. That's what redemption is. Redemption is when you made all these mistakes and it looked like you screwed up your life, and God says, I can work all things together for good. I can take that mistake that you made, and I'm going to factor it into my plan. I'm going to redeem it. That's one of the greatest things about following Christ, is watching God take people who have messed up their life. They've jacked up their life. They have made some bad choices. They hung out with some bad people. They've reaped the bad consequences. Who am I talking to? You have done some things that you regret, and you say, I'll never get my life back. And God says, I can redeem all that. I'm going to turn that around. I'm going to use it for good. You have no idea. That's what redemption means. Redemption is a good thing. Redemption is something we ought to praise God for, because he sees value in you. Listen to me. If you're a teenager in this room and you don't think you don't matter and you don't amount to much, God has a whole plan for your life. He sees value in you that you can't see today. And he gave his son Jesus to redeem you. The world's trying to mess you up, but he's redeemed all that. I love this verse. And then watch this. It's not only that he's redeemed me. He's created me. He's formed me. He's redeemed me. And then check this out. Fear not, he says, because I've called you by your name.
I love that. That tells me that God loves me. That means that I'm not just a number to God. I'm not just one of the billions, that he actually loves me like I'm one of his child. I'm a child of God. I'm a son of God. Turn to somebody next to you and say, better not mess with me. I'm a child of God. I am his son. I'm his daughter. I'm somebody special. Listen, I am an heir of God. I am a joint heir with Jesus Christ. I have been called by name. You're not an accident. It's not as if God has to figure out who you are. He knows you. That's what's actually amazing, that he knows you in spite of everything that you've done. He knows it all. He knows the hair on your head. Chief, he knows the hair on your head. I know the hair on your head, actually. God knows everything. He knows everything about you. And he loves you just the same. Listen, the most powerful thing that will ever happen in your life is when you get a revelation of how much God loves you. I pray today that God would awaken something up on the inside of you, help you realize how much God loves you, how much he cares about you, that he knows your name. You ever have somebody important just know your name? And you were like, and it had an impact on you because you weren't just a number. Somebody cared. Somebody remembered you. Listen, God knows you by name. You will never have victory in life unless you realize how much God loves you. You'll never have peace in your life until you know how much God loves you. And somebody here today, that's my message to you. God loves you. He saw all that you did. He's seen all the pain that you've gone through. He sees everything that's happened in the past. And God says, I care. I brought you to this moment. I've been trying to communicate to you. It's trying to turn you around. Weeping may endure for that night, but joy comes in the morning. And so he's trying to turn your life around. And I love this. He goes on to say that, fear not, I've redeemed you. I've called you by your name. And then we said it a second time, I've called you by your name. Somehow it just repeated it. That's like me amening myself right here. Only to say this, you are mine. God says you're mine. That means he's saying that you belong to me. God has said you're mine. That's incredible. That means that God, listen, if God owns something, if you belong to God, this is what I know, he takes care of everything that's his. That's what's so good. God has promised to take care of you, that he knows you. You're his. He's going to watch over you. He's going to protect you. That he's going to, watch this, he's going to fight your battles for you. This is what Isaiah was so excited about. He's saying, it was bad. You guys went away from God. But listen, if you'll just turn to him, he's going to be with you in everything that you do. And that's why this message is so powerful. If you will just recognize, you don't have to live in fear. In America, in this world, in 2021, you don't have to be afraid. Fear not. You can know that God says some things about your life. In fact, five things that you can pull out on your little notes and you can put it up and say, wait a second, I know that I've been created by God. I know that he's forming my life. I know that he's redeemed me. I know that he is calling me by my name. He knows who I am, and he's declared that I am his. I belong to him. Man, when you know that, when you have that deep inside of you, you can take on anything. That's what it means. This is where Joshua says, I know that he's with me. Whom shall I fear? I shall not be afraid. I will not be afraid. Listen, David said it. I can run through a troop. I can leap over a wall. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Who am I preaching to today? Who am I preaching to today? Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. He's called you mine. And I wanted to stop right there. I thought that could be the whole message. I could get you fired up, send you out, and that's all you need to hear. But verse 2 started calling to me. Because verse 1, that was enough. Verse 2 was just starting to say to me, Darryn, could you say something about me? And I didn't want to talk about verse 2 because I don't like how verse 2 starts. I don't even like the first word of the verse. So I thought I would just stop here, send you out with a shout, and that would be it. But verse 2 was saying, you got to talk about me. You guys ready for verse 2? Can I keep you just a couple minutes more? I'm almost finished. Verse 2 says, when you pass through the waters. And I hate that word, when. I didn't want it to be when. I wanted it to be if. I wanted it to be maybe some people will go through it, but it doesn't have to be me. But listen, that verse is saying, for everybody, there's going to come a when. There's going to become a moment when you go through the waters. And I love what it says, through the waters. But let's first talk about, what are the waters? So I had to study this. You know what this verse, the waters, what it means? That verse, that word in this particular context means dirty water, sewer water, urine-filled water, like water that's in Indiana slough runoff water. You don't want to be drinking it. It doesn't taste good. It's not good for you. It's bad. It's distasteful. You don't want to have that in your life. There's mess in it. And I stopped there and I thought, well, what does that mean? Because, you know, in the Bible, every time water shows up, I've taught you this before in the last series, anytime you see water, it represents a moment of transition. Moses led the people of Israel through the Red Sea. It marked a point of transition from slavery to freedom. Joshua leads the people to the Jordan River. It's a moment of transition. They're going to leave yesterday and they're going to head into their promised land. Elisha comes to that same point, and he becomes anointed as the successor of Elijah. It happens at the Jordan River, and he crosses over. Jesus transitions from his life of childhood and his previous life into his public ministry at the Jordan. Anytime you see water, it means a place of transition. And so here it says, this is some dirty water. This is some water that you wouldn't choose, you wouldn't want to be in. And I got excited when I started thinking about it, that God sees you when you go through situations that are distasteful to you, situations that you would never have picked, situations that you say, I don't want to be a part of that. I don't want to be even in it. God says, when you walk through those waters, I'm going to be with you. And notice what he says, through the waters. You're not going to the waters. You're not going there to stay. You're not going there to build a house. You're not going there to camp out. You're just going to go through the waters. And some of you, you're going into the water right now. Some of you are in the waters right now. Some of you are coming out of the waters right now. But you're not there to stay, because it is a moment where God is saying, this is a but now moment. You're just in a moment where God's about to transition you out of where you've been and into where he's taking you. That's exciting. That's an exciting moment, because you're not there to stay. And notice he says, I will be with you. I'm so grateful that when God took me into situations in my life that I hated, that I found so distasteful, that I said, God, I don't like it. And God said, I'm not going to abandon you there. I'm not going to leave you there. I'm not going to leave you by yourself. That's good news, everybody, when you know that God is with you no matter what. He's going to walk through those waters with you. And you know, if you don't know if you're in the water right now, just sniff the water and see if you're in a place that sounds like it doesn't smell good. You don't like where life has got you right now. Just know that God is with you right now, and you're not there to stay. So when you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. And then he says, and through the rivers. And I thought about that. That's a different kind of water. So the rivers in the Bible represent life. Rivers represent a transition into prosperity and blessing. And watch what he says. When you go through the rivers, they won't overflow you. And I got interested in that. And that said something to me, that God cares enough about me that he's not going to let blessing overflow me. Because you all know there are some people, not everybody can handle prosperity. There are some people who think that when they got blessed and prosperous in life, they thought they had pulled themselves up by their own bootstraps. And how many of you know, you didn't get there by yourself. You didn't do that by your own energy and intellect. God put you exactly where you are. God's given you everything that you have. God is the one who's provided everything. But there are people who can't handle it. And we have story after story of people who God blessed, and it just took them, it destroyed their lives. So God loves you enough, and he says, when you go through waters that are distasteful, I'm going to be with you, and I'm going to give you just enough to keep you dependent on me. Thank God. He gives me my daily bread. He doesn't give me more than I need so that I'm going to turn away from God. Because listen, truth be told, some of y'all, if you got everything God was giving to you, you'd stop coming to church. You wouldn't even want, I don't have to serve anybody anymore. I'm just going to go buy an island and be by myself. My wife's laughing. That's probably what we do, right? No, just kidding. Some of you, if God gave you everything that you asked for, it would destroy you. So that's why he says, look, I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to keep you dependent on me. And I've learned this over my life, and I can tell you this for a fact, that God never fails to meet your need. God will provide, but he gives you just what you need, so you'll stay dependent. You'll still keep crying out to him. You'll still keep reading your Bible. You'll still keep seeking after the Lord. You can thank God that not only is he with you in difficulty, but he's even with you in prosperity. He will keep you safe. I'm excited about it. And then he says, when you walk through the fire, when you walk through situations that are meant to destroy you. Some of you have gone through things that are so hard and so bad, you thought you were gonna die. You felt like it was gonna burn you. And God says, even if it gets that bad, you're gonna come through it. You're gonna actually come out and there won't even be the evidence that there was even a fire in your life. They won't even be able to smell the smoke. Anybody know that story?
Yeah.
It's a true story. Let me say, Isaiah is writing this, and about 100 years later, there's some young boys reading that says, you know what? If God's promised to be with us, we don't even have to be afraid of the fire, that God will be with us right in the middle of it, and he's gonna save us. And they came out of that situation without even the smell of smoke on them. That's what God is saying. That's what's exciting, that God says, I'm gonna not only bring you out of what you've brought, of what you've come through, I've been using all of it to shape you, to turn you back to me. But when you come out, there's not even going to be evidence of the fire in your life. Listen, I don't know who I'm preaching to you today. God is wanting to transition you. God's trying to change your life. He's turning you back to him. Turn to your neighbor and say, you don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be afraid. You don't have to be afraid. He's gonna be with you in the waters. He's gonna be with you in the rivers. He's gonna be with you in the fire. You don't have to be afraid. Who am I talking to today? Some of you, I know I'm talking to you because frankly, you're just parked by fear. You've stopped in the middle of your fears. You won't take the risk. You won't take the next step. God's trying to get you to step out, to follow him, to trust him, to move you. He's trying to save you. He's trying to lead you. He's trying to guide you. But some of you, you'll never do it because you're just scared. You don't have to be scared. You don't have to be afraid. God is right there with you. Some of people are even scared to give their lives to Christ, because they're afraid. They're, what will people say? You're scared even to lift your hand and to let somebody, what if somebody sees me if I lift my hand? Listen, that's the devil lying to you. There's not a person in this room that wouldn't just cheer you on and say, good for you, we've all done that same thing, and we're excited for you. We're glad you're going after God. But you sit there and you say, I'm scared. There's some people that won't follow after Christ because they're saying, well, I can't live up to my word to God. I'd let him down. I wouldn't be able to do what God's asked me to do. So you sit there scared to follow Christ. When, listen, no, you can't do it in your own power. But if you just give your life to Christ, his spirit would come live inside of you, and he would be able to help you do everything that he's asked you to do. He will empower you and strengthen you. Come on, everybody, be of good courage. Have strength. God is going to do something in your life. Well, I want to bring this message in for a close today. God cares about you. He knows you by name. When you pass through these waters that you're all going through, God has promised. I brought some of that to turn you around. I'm going to form you. I'm going to shape you. I'm going to redeem you. I'm going to bring you out. I'll be with you. My word to you, to somebody today, is when fear comes your way, stop being afraid. The greatest experiences in life come from confronting your fears. I used to be so afraid of getting up and speaking in front of people. Ask my wife. I would, when I started this church, I'd literally go in the back little bathroom and throw up every Sunday. So afraid. Tied to pages and pages of notes. Just afraid because of what somebody might think. And here I am living out my destiny today because I just said yes to God, and God had something that he was going to do through me that I couldn't even imagine. God has things for you that you can't see. God's got, some of you are scared to get married. Some of you are scared to trust God. Some of you are afraid to start businesses. Some of you are afraid to write that book. Some of you are afraid to just do the thing that God has called you to launch out and do. And I'm telling you, you cannot follow God in this day and age today and be someone who's just paralyzed by fear. Don't listen to the voice of fear any longer. Do you hear what I'm saying? Don't listen to fear. God is not the author of fear. God has given you not the spirit of fear, but he's given you a spirit of power and of love and of a sound mind. Do not be afraid. Move against your fear. You got this? All right, let's pray together. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your word. Thank you for the power of your word. Thank you for the clarity of your word. Thank you, Lord, that you have spoken to somebody here today. Now, Lord, I thank you that you have created us to be somebody who we're not today. Thank you, Lord, that you're forming us. Thank you that you've redeemed us. Thank you that you're changing us and you're calling us by name and You've said that we're yours, that we belong to you. So Lord, I pray that we will step out, even in the waters, in the difficult seasons, we're gonna trust that you're with us. We're not gonna be scared. God, even in prosperity, we're not gonna turn from you to the right or the left, we're gonna stay dependent on you. God, I thank you that even today, when the fire comes and we go through situations meant for our destruction, I thank you that you'll never abandon us. Thank you, God, that you fight our battles. Thank you that you go before us. You go before us, behind us, you're all around us. You are the God who protects us. So I pray in the name of Jesus that you will give your love to your people today. I pray you'd baptize every person with the richness of knowing that you love them. God, I pray that the Holy Spirit will fill their lives today. I pray that you would break the voice of condemnation, bind the enemy's voice of fear, of every doubt, of insecurity. God, I come against insecurity in Jesus' name. And I pray that you would set some people free. Break people free of their crippling fear today in Jesus' name, Lord. Now, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, somebody here, you're far from God and you know it. You've turned away. You've backslidden. You've just run from God and your life is all drama and you've been wondering what's going on. You can give your life to Christ today. No hesitation. No looking around. Just, I'm ready. You're ready to get forgiveness. You're ready to start anew. You're ready to have a real relationship with God. Lift your hand real quick right now and say, I need God in my life. Lift it up and then you can put it back down. Let me see it. Lift it up. No hesitation. I need God in my life today. Yes, I've got you. Anybody else? Lift it up. On the internet, just lift it up right now where you are. Yeah, I see you. Got you up there in the balcony. Anybody else? Pray this prayer with me in your heart today. God, I know that I need you. Tell him that. Just tell him that you need him more than I ever needed you before. I'm sorry, Lord. Tell him I'm sorry, Lord, for not living for you. I've lived my life without you. I did whatever seemed right in my own eyes. I'm sorry. Forgive me. Say this last part. Jesus, come into my life. Change me. Jesus, make me a new person. Say this last part. I surrender. I give you my whole life. Lord, I pray today that every person who's praying this prayer, you'd fill them with your love. Lord, you're going to change their life. You're going to give them a new beginning. You're going to heal. You're going to restore. You're going to lead them out. You're going to redeem every mistake. They're not going to be able to recognize themselves even a short time from now. Now, Lord, we just breathe you in. We thank you for your courage. We thank you for your strength. We will not live in fear. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Come on, everybody. Give God a great hand of praise. Yes, amen.